Welcome here to this seminar. We are glad we have this opportunity to talk about distance learning, and so we will experiment also this new framework, let's say, this new way of doing a seminar, very interactive, like it requires probably the topic we are going to explore.
This was a great challenge for us when we were deciding on doing this, workshop today, because you see, even among us, we're not very sure how far technology is really the issue when we're talking about distance learning. There is usually a trend that we put a lot of emphasis on technology, and we still miss what is really important, that is the people, right? But we still, one thing that we have to consider is that the students and ourselves now all have a computer in our pocket, that is our cell phones, right? When you mentioned, sorry, I don't remember your name.
Handa.
See, I can't use his method any longer. My hard drive is gone. So, when you said that, well, why would I have my students use their cell phones in a face-to-face class if I have the opportunity to talk directly to them? Well, maybe that's a challenge to make sure that they are using their cell phone to relate to you and not to something else at that moment that you want their attention. So, for example, when May, right? When May was a little slow writing her name in, all the colleagues were already saying, come on, why are you so slow? And then she's back to class. Right? So that we'll probably have to find ways in which we use the technology, even in our blended ways of teaching in a regular class. Right? Ray has just said one thing that I was thinking here that's very important. In many cases, we are either teaching the same thing to different groups in different parts of the world, and we could be, and I hope that in the future we'll be cooperating more and maybe saying, well, you know, I have this friend, for example, whenever I have to, I think about anything related to oceans and ocean studies, now I will always remember Ray, right? And I'm saying, why will I tell you about anything about the ocean if I have a specialist that is at, maybe at the other side of the world, but there has to be a connection again, you know, I have to tell, it's my friend, someone that I met when I was in Berkeley, not look at this thing that I found on the web, right? This thing that I found on the web is only the content is going to be important in only two situations, when it is personally related and then the students will also feel connected, or when we really did, and that's also an important thing that teachers should do, is when we really did spend our time harvesting whatever is there on the web to make sure that our students get access to something that we think that is important to them, right? And so we are basically showing them content that is already on YouTube or whatever, but it's content that we have already reviewed. And that's a problem that, well, I see Karen complaining all the time about teachers that are teaching online, and they just, you know, they Google for something and then they put some links there and they haven't even watched what they're telling their students to see. We have to, teachers have, I mean, our profession is finding good material and contextualizing this, making sure that this makes sense to our students, right? So there is a situation, in fact, there are many situations in which we will refer in our classes to content that is already there. And that's what I tried to do today. You know, we were discussing, okay, I'm originally a computer scientist or a computer engineering scientist, but that was almost 30 years ago, and then I was a specialist on technology here to bring the 5G thing. I did a lot of telecommunications in the past. I even helped build one of the first mobile, exchanges for networks for the south of Brazil 30 years ago, but that's history. I don't know much about the current technology. So I was, you know, during the last 2 weeks, I was there reviewing a lot of stuff on the web and checking, and I got to a video that I want to show you, just to explain where 5G is going, right? But before we get to talk about, well, where 5G is going, 5G for now, and that's something that I learned even better during this last 2 weeks that I was preparing for this class, 5G is really marketing more than anything else right now. You know, what we had in the past, I remember in the 70s, I was a little kid, my grandfather had this, one of his brothers was very successful. He was a very successful entrepreneur and got really rich. And he was this guy who walked around, well, he drove his car around, and he had what we would call a mobile phone today. A kid today would say, well, that's probably a prehistoric, a dinosaur time mobile phone. It wasn't a mobile phone, it was a radio phone, right? It was something big that you almost needed your two hands to talk, but it was, let's say, it was not connected to the wall, right? That was the technology in the 70s. Then in the 80s, we started having the first cell phones. It was 89 when I was working on the development of switches or exchanges for mobile phones in Brazil. So it was basically at the end of the 80s that we had the first mobile phones around. Even here in the States, the second half of the 80s was when people, for the first time, noticed that they could take their phone and put it in their pockets and walk around, right? But they were phones that were there only to talk, right? You couldn't do any data. After that, in the 90s, well, we start being able to send. Do you remember the SMS or texting? Beginning of texting.
We still have,
and that only proves how legacy
it's
works.
Especially here in the US,
it's crazy. They love texting, right? And
it's but anyway, than WhatsApp in Brazil.
For some reason they never found out about WhatsApp. We tell them and say, well, but you know that's probably because they are, most of them here are on Apple phones, where texting is a little easier than it is, at least with the technology that we were used to. The 2000s, we got to online, started experiencing the possibilities of some online use of cell phones, so data started to be there. But it was only actually when we started having, this was the beginning of the smartphones, and you probably say, hey, that was 2000, but it actually only happened at the end of the first decade, right? And then now we have, after 2010, we started, in 2010 is when we started hearing about 4G, and you know what? 4G is something that is just about to happen now. Everyone is talking about 5G, but it's only now that what was promised here as the 4G technology that we're getting to. You know, it's only now that we're getting to the speeds that were said that we would have for 4G and everything. And along the time, they came up with this long-term evolution term here that was 4G LTE. I don't know if anyone bought into that. It was basically saying, well, you know, we're not there yet, but we're evolving to that. We will get that to that. So we got to that. You know, nowadays, with 4G LTE-A advanced, we actually got to 4G, right? And now we're talking about next year getting to 5G. You know, what we're getting here is to what 4G was 10 years ago. What we're getting here is to a promise of what it will be in 2030. Most of it, you'll see, I'll play a video. It will all have an impact in distance learning the same way as it will have a huge impact in our lives. I mean, we are different creatures today to what we were 10 years ago, for the good or for the bad. And in many cases, I would say more for the bad. But anyway, we became different creatures because we have our phones in our hands all the time. And even if teachers put that cell phone aside, you know, it looks to the board and the kids are again with there, right? So we shouldn't be that concerned about how quickly this is going to impact us in distance learning, because, you know, my feeling, and you know what Karin and I have been discussing for at least the last 15 years when we're doing business learning is, you know what, technology is changing, it's changing fast, but when we think about the way we're using it and the benefit that we're getting from it to involve our students, there's still a lot that we can do that could be using technologies that are not so sophisticated. Do we really need to have augmented reality to teach a new class? Our students will be exposed to augmented reality, which is really basically just maybe putting their phone in front of an image and seeing that image plus a lot of additional content or information, virtual reality and everything, right? So they will be exposed to those kind of things in other aspects of their lives. And of course, this will have to somehow influence the way we teach, because otherwise our classes are going to be boring, right? To the way that they are becoming, let's say, hardwired. Okay. All right. So now I think this is the video, and let me see if I can use the technology the way. Hang on. I will get there. Look. Now I have to put it here, and if I am, I have to do this really fast.
Click.
And now I click. Isn't that exciting? Couldn't I just press the button?
So there's faster speeds and more functionality to our smartphones. 1G brought us the very first cell phones. 2G let us text for the first time. 3G brought us online, and 4G delivered the speeds that we enjoy today. But as more users come online, 4G networks have just about reached the limit of what they're capable of at a time when users want even more data for their smartphones and devices. Now we're headed toward 5G, the next generation of wireless. It will be able to handle 1,000 times more traffic than today's network. We're still working out many of the kinks with millimeter waves, small cell networks, massive MIMO, beamforming, and full duplex. In fact, all of 5G is still a work in progress. It will likely include other new technologies too, and making all of these systems work together will be a whole other challenge. But if experts can figure that out, ultra-fast 5G service could arrive in the next 5 years.
If you think that the technology here is overwhelming, you're probably not alone. Even engineers are still having a lot of trouble to put this together, and this is why it's going to take another 5 years, but it's going to be 10 years I'm sure that if we had an opportunity to reassess this in 10 years, we'll say, yes, we're finally getting to the 5G. There's a lot of technical challenges there. And at the same time, if we think, how does that directly affect distance learning? Well, this is probably what we'll be discussing next when Ray moderates our World Cafe here. But the thing is, probably not because we will be using this technology so directly in teaching, but because we as a society will be suffering, let's say, the results of being subject to that kind of technology. The same way as that now, if someone asks us on the street, how do I get from here to another, to whatever other street? I remember that once I was, maybe about 7 or 8 years ago, I came to a conference in Chicago, and I asked someone on the street, I knew that it was 3 blocks away from my hotel, and I asked someone on the street if they knew where that hotel was, and I thought it was so impressive that this girl, she was a teenager, she got her cell phone, I was still, at that stage I still had my Nokia on me, she got her smartphone and checked the street, and instead, she didn't know, it was 2 blocks away, but she already didn't know. We become different creatures when we use different technologies. Yeah. Right? In the past, we knew where things were, at least in our neighborhood. Now we don't. I think we will have to think of our ways of teaching, not because the technology affects the way of teaching, but because it affects our students, it affects ourselves in other ways, and that will have to be also part of our thinking of teaching.
Yeah.